Good afternoon and welcome to All Saints Cathedral as we pray our sister Gloria on to her greater reward. My name is Kevin Carroll and I serve as the dean here. And we all have known Gloria in different ways at different times of our lives. And a few people wanted to share a little bit about their relationship with Gloria. And so before we start the service, I would invite Milton Band to come up and share his remembrances.
Okay, good afternoon, everybody. Before I start, my name is Milton Bond. I like to give honor to God, and I like to give honor to the family. The first thing I'd like to say about Dr. Gilmer is one word: accomplished. She's a very accomplished person. She started with her upbringing. She raised an accomplished family. Her son, who's an accomplished attorney who graduated from NYU. Her daughter, who's an accomplished business person, who graduated from Northwestern University in graduate school. Her grandchildren, who are both accomplished, and one of her grandsons is a global dancer for the LA Dance Company internationally. And with that said, I just like to tell you just a little bit about myself. I was blessed to be a friend of Gloria. I'm also an educator, so I'm going to just give you a little lesson about Gloria. When I think of Gloria, three things come to mind: mathematics, history, and God. Now, some of you might think, well, how does they go together? Well, math, we have a word called correlation. You know, and correlation just means how one variable affects the other. Gloria, I like to start out with a little story because, you know, from my background, anybody ever heard of Gloria Engler Wilder? Yeah, she was the author of the Little House on the Prairie series back in the day before Michael Landon played the paw, right? We used to have books and we used to have to read them. And and I remember I used to have to read, you know, those books, and I used to think the father was this big burly guy and he had this beard, and all of a sudden the TV came and it was Michael Landon. I'm like, that's little Joe. That's not Pa. Yeah. Well, it's fun. And the reason I said that is because Dr. Gilmer said we have to imagine. You know, that's the key. We have to imagine. And she says, that's how we see the future. You know? So, from that, the reason I picked Little House on the Prairie is because they were pioneers. But Dr. Gilmer, as you know, was a trailblazer. And she made it so we can follow her paths. And then people like me are the pioneers, you know. And then the people who I help teach, they're the settlers. But what we have to remember is we can't just rest on our laurels, because those paths will get grown over. So we all have to be trailblazers. We all do. You know, just like she was a trailblazer, Dr. Gilmer was the first Afro-American to publish research articles in mathematics. She earned a Ph.D. in curriculum instruction at Marquette. She was the first Afro-American to teach mathematics at MATC, and the first Afro-American to teach at the Milwaukee public school system. She also was the first Afro-American to sit on the Mathematical Association of American board. Okay, and she also believed in ethno-mathematics. Now, going back to my childhood, you know, I used to like to read Charles Schulz. And there's kind of a theme there, because Laurie Ingalls Wilder's from Minnesota. Charles Schulz was also from Minnesota. And I did my undergrad at Minnesota. But I wonder why I ended up there. Maybe because of the influence I had from those two great authors. But anyways, as we know of Charles Schulz, we had Charlie Brown. And one, the reason I can relate to Charlie Brown, because if anybody understand about that, you know, series, remember how the teacher would go blah, 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 blah? And nobody kind of understood what the teacher was talking about? And then how we just kind of like, you know, and then how Charlie Brown would just try to kick the ball, and Lucy would always just take the ball away from him, and he would just fall, and like, ah, you know? And then when he would trick-or-treat, he would always get a rock. Well, that's kind of how people felt about math. They felt like, ah, the ball's already been taken away from me. Or how come I always get a bad grade? It's like getting a rock. Well, Dr. Gilmer, with her ethnomathematics, she's like, we're going to rewrite the script. You know, you don't have to accept this. You know, this is not who you are. You know, you have a history of mathematics. And we're going to make it so you can kick that ball. Because Dr. Gilmer is a very inquisitive person. The one thing about Dr. Gilmer was she was a seeker of universal truth. And that goes back to my theme about mathematics, God, and history. God is about universal truth. There's some things in mathematics we call postulates. Postulates are something that are just, you know, terms that are undefined, and then from those undefined terms, we define them. We do that in law, we do that in mathematics, you know. We have undefined times, because really, what's a point? Does anybody really know what a point is? I mean, how big is a point? How long is a point? Because Dr. Gilmer worked in a grocery store. She understood measurements, okay? So, bottom line is, she understood, you know, how to reach people like me, people in our community. She was a global person. She was a community person. And I know I'm running out of time, so I just want to leave you one last thing. Dr. Gilmer, what I learned from Dr. Gilmer was, never underestimate the power of dreams and the influence of the human spirit, because we are all the same in God's eyes, and the potential for greatness live within every one of us. God bless you. Have a good day.
Thank you very much. And now we are going to hear from Ramona Dix Williams.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Ramona Dix Williams, and I want to first give my condolences and prayers and love to the family, and just tell you about my experiences with Gloria. She credits the church for her vision, faith, and strength to move forward in her chosen field of mathematics, having grown up in Baltimore in the 1940s with an all-black congregation. The minister actually had a graduate degree in math, and two of her high school teachers in calculus and algebra were also members of the Episcopal Church as well in Baltimore. And so it was through their vision that she had, she credits them and said so in an interview, with moving forward in that area, and had the dream and vision that she could do it. And coming in the 1940s as a black woman in mathematics, not common at all. And so it was that same faith and vision that brought her to Madison in 1957, where later she moved to Milwaukee and formed lifelong friendships along with her marriage to Jay Gilmer. But that included my mother. And my mother and Gloria were lifelong friends for over four decades with each other. They both had moved to Milwaukee in the late 50s from other places. They were both teaching in MPS in high school at that time as one of the few black teachers in high school back in the early 60s, late 50s, and pioneers in both the fields that they had chosen, with Gloria being in mathematics. And then later she went on, of course, to other things, MATC, universities, etc. But also they were together because they were also in the same sorority, Black Greek Letter Sorority, Alpha Kappa Alpha, together. And lastly, but most importantly, they were bonded because they were both members of the Episcopal Church. And to have in Milwaukee black congregants in the church, well, first of all, the Episcopal Church is a small denomination in this area to begin with. and then to find black members of the church was even more rare, more common along the East Coast, et cetera, but to come to Milwaukee and find someone that also was a member of the church. So that was an instant bond between them as well. So they had many, many years together as friends, as well as our fathers were friends. So I grew up with her in my life all my life. And I saw her in many roles as mother, mentor, friend, teacher, advocate, and all of that. And so in each of those roles, she was also a teacher. And so as mother, of course, growing up with her and my mom, you know, they were women of their time, strong black women, educated, the small black middle class that existed in Milwaukee at that time, there were expectations. So as a child of that, you knew exactly what those expectations were. You know, you got that look, or you got that tone, you knew to straighten up right away. It wasn't if you were going to college, it was what college were you going to. You know, it was all about expectations, being raised in a certain idea and conduct and et cetera. And it was at through Gloria's house that I learned early lessons along with Jay and Jill about community and volunteerism. We did the Jerry Lewis Telethon, raising money for that and some other community activities at her home, through her home, and being with them. So those were first early lessons in really being a voice in the community, which was one thing that Gloria was always a voice in the community. And then moving forward as mentor, you know, just watch her guide and give words of wisdom to anybody and everybody around her. You know, she never expected more from anybody else than she really expected from herself. You know, for her to go back and get her Ph.D. after raising children, et cetera, as a black woman at Marquette, that was quite an accomplishment when you really think about what she had to sacrifice to do something like that at that time. That was not common. But she also guided many, brought words of wisdom. She was even a guide to my own husband at MATC, to my son that was here and left earlier throughout his life at Carter's Child Development Center, and then also through just knowing him and mentoring him and helping him along through his years. But she also was a mentor to many. And there, and as was also spoken by Mr. Bonnie, who also could talk about her as a mentor, and many more could get up and talk about that, and saw her as a friend. And she was a lifelong friend to my parents later, friend to me and my family. She was a kind, loving friend, a lot of hours of fun at her home, cookouts, barbecues, gatherings for dinner. My mother and she had parties together at that time. You know, many people used to do parties at their homes, and they certainly did. They knew she was a serious woman, but she knew how to have fun. So, you know, she laughed, she had a soft laugh, but just really just very engaged always with those around her. And so then she came on, you know, we continued that to, you know, have dinner at her home and everything, and just have, you know, time for laughing and remembering and just talking about the world events around the table. And she really, you know, was a good friend and teacher in that way. And then as an advocate, you know, she certainly was a voice in the community and a leader in her field and profession, a leader in terms of community. She went on to chair the Social Justice Committee through the Episcopal Church, and I had the opportunity to sit in on some of those meetings at the time and could watch and just watched her at work. You know, she led in a firm but kind way. When she talked, people listened. And so that was amazing to, again, get that early lesson as well on how to be a voice in the community and push for change. She went on to also, you know, volunteer at Carter's Child Development Center as part of her work there with the family and staff around mathematics, but also developing the ethnomathematics that she later became, you know, pioneered in the mathematical field. And so some of that work was done through her work there at Carter's Child Development Center as well. and she was involved with other community activities, including the sorority and leadership there. And through it all, she was a teacher, first and foremost, you know, always looking for opportunity to teach one-on-one, peer-to-peer, in group, classroom, et cetera, articles, you know, always giving back, always giving back, always being a voice of concern, always being community-minded. And all of that I learned and saw from her and was able to move in those same footsteps with her as a mentor, as a friend, as a mother, as a guide, as a teacher. So in all these roles, she was also a lifelong walk of faith, and the church was always there. She was always part of the church, part of the walk with the Lord, part of always giving back, part of always being a community leader and a servant leader. So Gloria's legacy will always be there through her children, her grandchildren, friends, families, colleagues, through her profession and the legacy that she's left there in ethnomathematics, other things that she's done in her world of profession, and also through just everything that she has planted in so many of the seeds that she has planted that others have grown to become more and to do more and have a higher quality of life because of her in it. So to Gloria, I would like to say, rest in peace and love. You will always be remembered. You are already missed. And my love and condolences to the family. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
And finally, we'll hear from Elaine Effort.
Good afternoon. When I first start to think about my remarks, I quickly sat down at the computer and started typing. Well, after 20 pages, I thought, oh my goodness, these aren't remarks. This is the first chapter of a book. I left that at home. Today is the day that the Lord hath made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Dean, my dear family, friends and friends I haven't met, we are giving thanks and praise as we celebrate the remarkable life of Gloria Ford Gilmer, my cousin Gloria. Cousin Gloria was brilliant, scholarly, accomplished, and to her credit, she was hugely accessible. She did not retreat and become absorbed in thought and problem solving, away as in a distant ivory tower. She was always present, on the scene, in the fray, mixing it up with her family, students, elected officials, priests, fellow parishioners, sores, neighbors, store clerks. You get the idea. She was engaging and innately curious. She was truly interested in what you had to say and how you saw things and why. As a result, Cousin Gloria had a profound impact on her family and community. She was a lifelong learner. Always interested in the latest ideas, Cousin Gloria became involved and even hopeful in the work of those pursuing racial reconciliation, racial justice, and restorative justice. She became active in those causes and engaged others. She was never, ever satisfied with the status quo. You never heard her say, oh, well, that's just the way it is. Mm-mm. She would ask, how can we make it better? Let's work on a plan. Cousin Gloria's academic achievements speak for themselves, but from my point of view, my cousin Gloria was a shining star in our family for being inspirational, encouraging, and loving. I'm eternally grateful I was in her orbit. We'll always have the glorious summers in Green Lake and family reunions everywhere from Chicago, D.C., Key West, and Biloxi, Mississippi. Thanksgivings in Tampa Bay, Pittsburgh, Detroit, Connecticut, and Milwaukee, not to mention Christmas and Easter dinners and long, boisterous chats after big meals. Our last family adventure was in Copenhagen, where we strolled through the Tivoli Gardens and attended an Alvin Ailey Dance Theater Company's performance there to take in her grandson, Cousin James, international debut. In summary, I'd like to share this message by Michael Josephson that Cousin Gloria sent to my daughter, April, upon her graduation from university. This is just a portion of Josephson's What Matters. In the end, what will matter? How will the value of your days be measured? What will matter is not what you bought, but what you built. Not what you got, but what you gave. What will matter is not your success, but your significance. What will matter is not what you learned, but what you taught. What will matter is every act of integrity, compassion, courage, and sacrifice that enriched, empowered, or encouraged others to emulate your example. What will matter is not your competence, but your character. What will matter is not how many people you knew, but how many will feel a lasting loss when you're gone. What will matter is not your memories, but the memories of those who loved you. What will matter is how long you will be remembered, by whom and for what. Living a life that matters doesn't happen by accident. It's not a matter of circumstance, but of choice. I praise God that Cousin Gloria chose to live a life that matters. Thank you.
Thank you all for sharing how you knew Gloria in a way, and I hope that this sharing can continue after the service as we share some fellowship and some food back down through the library into the parish hall following the service. So we're now going to begin in just in a minute, and the service is in its entirety in the white service booklet. So if you didn't pick one up on the way in, there's some more in the back, and thank you for being here.
words from Scripture. I am resurrection and I am life, says the Lord. Whoever has faith in me shall have life, even though he die. And everyone who has life and has committed himself to me in faith shall not die forever. As for me, I know that my Redeemer lives, and that at the last he will stand upon the earth. After my awaking, he will raise me up, and in my body I shall see God. I myself shall see, and my eyes behold him who is my friend, and not a stranger. For none of us has life in himself, and none becomes his own master when he dies. For if we have life, we are alive in the Lord, and if we die, we die in the Lord. So then, whether we live or die, we are the Lord's possession. Happy from now on are those who die in the Lord. So it is, says the Spirit, for they shall rest from their labor. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. O God, who by the glorious resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ, destroyed death and brought life and immortality to light, grant that your servant Gloria, being raised with him, may know the strength of his presence and rejoice in his eternal glory, who with you and the Holy Spirit lives and reigns, one God, forever and ever. Please be seated.
A reading from the prophet Isaiah. Comfort, oh comfort my people, says your God. Speak tenderly to Jerusalem and cry to her that she has served her term, that her penalty is paid, that she has received from the Lord's hand double for all her sins. A voice cries out, in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord. Make straight in the desert a highway for our God. Every valley shall be lifted up, and every mountain and hill be made low. The uneven ground shall become level, and the rough places a plain. Then the glory of the Lord shall be revealed, and all people shall see it together, for the mouth of the Lord has spoken. A voice cries out, and I said, what shall I cry? All people are grass. Their constancy is like the flower of the field. The grass withers, the flower fades. When the breath of the Lord blows upon it, surely the people are grass. The grass withers, the flower fades. But the word of our God will stand forever. The word of the Lord.
Good morning. Let us pray together the 23rd Psalm, found on page 4 in the service bulletin. The Lord is my shepherd.
I shall not want.
He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil. My cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Amen.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
I will do a New Testament reading from Romans 8:14 through 19, 34 through 35, 37 through 39. And this is the New Revised Standard Version. A reading from the letter of Paul to the Romans. For all who are led by the Spirit of God are children of God, for you do not receive a spirit of slavery to fall back into fear, but you have received a spirit of adoption. When we cry, Abba, Father, it is that very Spirit bearing witness with our spirit that we are children of God. And if children, then heirs. Heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ. If, in fact, we suffer with him so that we may also be glorified with him. I consider that the sufferings of this present time are not worth comparing with the glory about to be revealed to us. For the creation waits with eager longing for the revealing of the children of God. Who is to condemn? Is it Christ who died? Yes, who was raised, who is at the right hand of God, who indeed intercedes for us. Who will separate us from the love of Christ? Will hardship or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? No, in all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, not powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. The word of the Lord.
Thank you. Please stand for the reading of the gospel.
Please be seated. When I was a child, I thought that my mother could predict the future, especially when it came to some kind of misconduct on the part of my brother or my sisters. It was amazing how many times she would say, "I told you that this would happen. Remember, I told you that if you came home late or with bad grades, you would be grounded?" And inevitably, as I was sitting in my room on a Friday night when all my friends were going out, I would think to myself that it was uncanny how that old lady could predict that I would be sitting in my room that night by myself. She told us that it would happen, and sure enough, here I am, just like she said if I would. Well, I came to realize that my mother was not a fortune teller. She could not predict the future any more than I could. What she actually was a prophet. She spoke with a prophetic voice. Now, all too often, people have the perception that the prophets of the Old Testament were clairvoyant, that they could predict the future, like the prophet Isaiah that we heard from in the first lesson this morning. And all too often, the warnings that the prophets issued came to pass, and then in hindsight, gave the impression that they were able to predict the future. And that was exactly the opposite of what was really going on. The prophets of the Old Testament, the prophets of our own age, did not dwell in the future. They dwelt squarely in the here and now. And it was the role of the prophet to speak truth to power and to hold up the current reality and then offer choices to the people that they were talking to. Isaiah was speaking with his prophetic voice in an age when God's chosen people had started to turn away from God. People began to put their trust in false idols. The poor were being exploited. The widows and the orphans were not being taken care of. And those who came from alien lands were being enslaved and mistreated. Kind of sounds familiar, doesn't it? And then Isaiah, like all the prophets, would hold up what was going on like a mirror and tell the people, "You have two choices. You can continue on the path that you have set yourself on, or you can turn back to God. You can stay on the road to perdition and face the consequences, or you can return to God, repent of your sin, seek God's forgiveness, and live into the fullest potential that God wants his people to live into." All too often, the people of Israel chose the road to perdition and ended up being enslaved by foreign powers or sent into exile. And in retrospect, it did seem like the prophets were predicting the future, because sure enough, exactly what they said would happen, happened. Today, we are praying our sister Gloria into the hands of our loving God, and we will commit her remains to their resting place, where she, like all of us, one day will wait for that last great day when we will all be raised up and come into the presence of God, and the whole creation will be made new. Today, we are laying to rest a prophet. Through her life, her work, her teaching, the example she set, she held up the current reality and taught us that we have choices to make, and that if we make the right choices, the world will be a remarkably better place for that. I first met Dr. Gilmer 20 years ago, in 2003, and I was a seminarian, and I was supposed to teach an adult ed series at the church I was intern at, on racism. And I was talking to a priest in our diocese about the project, and he told me I need to go talk to a woman named Gloria Gilmer. And at that time, she was active on our diocese commission on racial justice. Gloria introduced me to the concept of systemic racism, something that I had virtually no knowledge of. She received me graciously into her home, the home that she would
live in for the rest of her life, the home where her daughter Jill so lovingly took care of her through her last days. And we sat at that kitchen table, and we started talking about the inherent biases that we all have. And as we are inclined to do, when a prophet holds up the mirror, we tend to become a bit defensive. And I balked a little bit. And I said something like, "Dr. Gilmer, you really don't know me, but some of my best friends growing up are black, and I'm not a racist." Well, she smiled at me in that gentle but powerful way and said something like, "Kevin, I think we have a lot to talk about." And we did. And over the course of a couple months, we talked frequently. And I learned about bias, and I learned about prejudice and privilege. I came to understand that systemic racism was not a character flaw of an individual, but the original sin of a nation. I came to realize, it was the original sin of a nation where people were being exploited, the original sin of a nation I came to understand the world as a place where systemic racism was the original sin of our nation that was birthed on the backs of slaves and on the genocide of indigenous people in this land. And she taught me how this insidious sin permeated our society and our political and our economic systems. And then, fully armed with this knowledge and this new awareness that she brought me into, I eventually stood up in front of that adult ed class at my church. And eventually somebody stood up to me and said, "You know, you don't know me that well, but I'm not a racist." And I thought to myself, we have a lot to talk about. Well, unfortunately, more than 50 years after listening to the prophetic voices of Dr. King, the prophetic acts that people performed marching in the streets when I was a child in the 60s, people demanding justice, we still have a lot more to talk about in our society. And we've heard stories from you, from her friends and her family, as you testified to her life, a wife, a mother, a teacher, a role model, a woman who was a pioneer in many ways. And through her words and her actions, we heard and saw a prophet in our own time, holding up the reality and giving us choices, helping us to be better moral and ethical people because of what she taught, what she stood for. And like that poem was remarkable about what we do, not what we say. But one other characteristic of a prophet was that it was also a voice of hope. Alongside the voice of warning, it was always the prophetic voice calling for change, and there was always a message of hope that was attached to those messages. Hope that God had for humanity. Humanity that was created in God's image and likeness, as we all are. Humanity that God loved so much that he sent Jesus, his only begotten Son, into the world not to condemn us, but to save us. And at a time like this, when someone we know and loves is called from this world and death, we mourn that loss, we do. We mourn their grieving, we mourn their passing. And that's a good and a right thing to do because that means we love that person. And that person loved us. And as so many of you said, when you spoke with Gloria, it was like you were the only person in the world. And you knew, sitting at that kitchen table, that you were loved. But at a time like this, we also need to listen to other prophetic voices in our lives. We need to assess where we stand in relationship to the current realities that we find ourselves in. And as we reflect on Gloria's life, we're also called to reflect on our own lives. where we are in terms of our own moral and ethical lives, where we are in our walk with God and our neighbors and ourselves. I also think at a time like this, we're called upon, we, not just them, we, everybody sitting here in this room, we are called also to speak with a prophetic voice in the tradition of the prophets, of Jesus, of the social reformers of our times, of those who put their lives on the line, those who lost their lives, demanding equality for all God's people. We are called to hear the prophetic voices of our young people who are marching through the streets demanding justice for the disenfranchised, for the downtrodden. Those young people who marched in Minneapolis and in Baltimore and here in Milwaukee. We are called to remember Gloria's gentle and at the same time powerful voice. And not just to heed their words, not just to heed her words, we are also called upon to speak those words ourselves. We live in a world that seems to be regressing in many ways. Bigotry and racism and anti-Semitism, ugly biases of all kinds seem to be raising their ugly heads. And in the 21st century, it's time to silence those voices that speak with hatred, but not with violence, not with those tactics of evil, but with the voice of love and with the voice of hope. That is how we can honor the legacy that Gloria worked hard to leave. So after we lay Gloria's remains to rest, after we share fellowship with each other, after we grieve, let's go out into the world speaking with our own prophetic voice. Let us go out into the world and not only talk a good talk, but walk the walk and do the work that we're called to do. We're called to speak a message of hope to each other. Hope born in the resiliency of the human spirit, which she believes so deeply in. Hope born of the reality that we are all made in the image and likeness of God, all of us. Hope born of a God who loves humanity more than we can comprehend. A hope that says we can leave our children a world that is a much better place. Much better place for having Gloria in it. Thanking God for the sure and certain hope in our resurrection to eternal life on that last great glorious day, which is the central tenet of our Christian faith. So as we go out into the world today, listen for the prophets, but at the same time, be the prophet. Be that voice in the world that needs to hear the message. Be that voice in the world that does not simply put up with all the stuff that's going on, but a voice that tries to quash it with hope, with love, and with charitability. That's what I learned from talking with Gloria. May she, like all the faithful departed, through the mercy of God, rest in peace and rise in glory.
I would invite you to rise as we affirm our Christian faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed found on page 5 in the worship booklet. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father.
He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
For our sister Gloria, let us pray to our Lord Jesus Christ, who said, I am resurrection and I am life. Lord, you consoled Martha and Mary in their distress. Draw near to us who mourn for Gloria, and dry the tears of those who weep.
Hear us, Lord.
You wept at the grave of Lazarus, your friend. Comfort us in our sorrow.
Hear us, Lord.
You raised the dead to life. Give to our sister eternal life.
Hear us, Lord.
You promised paradise to the thief who repented. Bring our sister to the joys of heaven.
Hear us, Lord.
Our sister was washed in baptism and anointed with the Holy Spirit. Give her fellowship with all your saints.
Hear us, Lord.
She was nourished with your body and blood. Grant her a place at the table in your heavenly kingdom.
Hear us, Lord.
Comfort us in our sorrows at the death of our sister Gloria. Let our faith be our consolation and eternal life our hope.
Lord Jesus Christ, we commend to our sister Gloria, who was reborn by water and the Spirit in holy baptism. Grant that her death may recall to us your victory over death and be an occasion for us to renew our trust in your Father's love. Give us, we pray, the faith to follow where you have led the way and where you live and reign with the Holy Spirit, one God, the ages of ages. Amen. And God's peace be with you all.
And also with you.
Please be seated. Now, normally at this time, I'd ask everybody to shake hands and hug and exchange greetings with each other, but we are still in this unusual season of COVID. So thank you for being here with us today. We are going to celebrate Holy Communion right now. And in the Episcopal Church, all baptized Christians are welcome to receive Holy Communion. Because it is not a Protestant table, it is not a Catholic table, it's not an evangelical table, that is the Lord's table. And all are welcome. We have communion with bread, small hosts, and also we have communion wine for small individual cups. And so if you'd like to partake of the wine, just simply take a cup from the communion minister and drink it and then put it back in the tray. Also, following the service, you're invited back to the Guildhall for refreshments to continue our conversation, our stories about Gloria, how she's impacted all of us in so many ways. She was just a remarkable person right up to the very end. I think I saw her like a week or so before she died. And even in that state, she was just distinguished. And you could tell that she was a strong person and that even the ravages of cancer and of dementia were not going to hold her back. And she was well on her way to meeting her Lord. And so we'll pray her out. At the end of the service, we're going to take her ashes back and inter them in our columbarium. And it's kind of a small spot. And so the family will come back and we'll put the ashes in the columbarium. It's a very short service, very, very short. And you'll be able to hear what's going on back there through the PA system. And then when that's finished, come on back for refreshments. Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us, an offering and a sacrifice to God. Please stand. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts, Lord, and let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give you thanks. It is truly right to glorify you, Father, and to give you thanks, for you alone are God, living and true, dwelling in light and accessible from before time and forever. Fountain of life and source of all goodness, you made all things and filled them with your blessing. You created them to rejoice in the splendor of your radiance. Countless throngs of angels stand before you to serve you night and day, and beholding the glory of your presence, they offer you unceasing praise. Joining with them and giving voice to every creature under heaven, we acclaim you and glorify your name as we say, Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. I would invite you to stand or kneel as you feel comfortable. We acclaim you, Holy Lord, glorious in power. Your mighty works reveal your wisdom and love. You formed us in your own image, giving the whole world into our care, so that in obedience to you, our Creator, we might rule and serve all your creatures. When our disobedience took us far from you, you did not abandon us to the power of death. In your mercy, you came to our help, so that in seeking you, we might find you. Again and again, you called us into covenant with you, and through the prophets, you taught us to hope for salvation. Father, you loved the world so much that in the fullness of time, you sent your only Son to be our Savior. Incarnate by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, he lived as one of us, yet without sin. To the poor, he proclaimed the good news of salvation. To prisoners, freedom. To the sorrowful, joy. To fulfill your purpose, he gave himself up to death, and rising from the grave, destroyed life and made the whole creation new. That we might live no longer for ourselves, but for him who died and rose for us, he sent the Holy Spirit, his own first gift for those who believe, to complete his work in the world, and to bring fulfillment, the sanctification of all. When the hour had come for him to be glorified by you, his heavenly Father, having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. At supper he took bread, and when he had given thanks to you, he broke it, and gave it to his disciples and said, Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me. After supper, he took the cup of wine. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the New Testament, or New Covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me. Father, we now celebrate this memorial of our redemption, recalling Christ's death and descent among the dead, proclaiming his resurrection and ascension to your right hand, and awaiting his coming in glory, and offering to you from the gifts you have given us this bread and this wine. We praise you and we bless you. We pray for you, we bless you, we give thanks to you, and we pray for you, Lord, our God. Lord, we pray that in your goodness and mercy, your Holy Spirit may descend upon us and upon these gifts, sanctifying them and showing them to be holy gifts for your holy people, the bread of life and the cup of salvation, the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Grant that all who share this bread and cup may become one body and one spirit, a living sacrifice in Christ to the praise of your name. Remember, Lord, your one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church, redeemed by the blood of your Christ. Reveal its unity, guard its faith, preserve it in peace. We pray for Michael, our presiding bishop, Jeffrey, our bishop, and all who minister in your church. Remember Gloria. Remember all who have died in the peace of Christ and whose faith is known to you alone.
Bring them into that place of eternal joy and life. And grant that we may find our inheritance with the Blessed Virgin Mary, with the patriarchs, the prophets, the apostles, the martyrs, and all the saints who have found favor with you in the ages past. We pray you in union with them and give you glory through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Through Christ and with Christ and in Christ, all honor and glory are yours, Almighty God and Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit forever and ever. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Hallelujah, Christ, our Passover is sacrificed for us. Therefore, let us keep the feast. The gifts of God for the people of God, holy food for holy people. Thank you. I would be remiss if I did not thank my colleague, Reverend Oswald Betchwell, for being here today. He was a glorious pastor at St. Martin's Episcopal Church for many years. And for our musical leadership from Lee Erickson, our cathedral organist, and Abby Rose Forsman over there, who is our excellent cantor, and Mr. Gary Campy, who is assisting today. As I said, we will, after this short part of the service, we will take Gloria's ashes back into the columbarium as we sing her out to How Great Thou Art. And in the meantime, I would ask you to please turn to page 8 and stand as we offer thanks for the communion which we just received. And let us pray. Almighty Father, we thank you for feeding us with the holy food of the body and blood of your Son, and for uniting us through him in the fellowship of your Holy Spirit. We thank you for raising up among us faithful servants for the ministry of your holy sacrifice. We pray that Gloria may be to us an effective example in word and action, in love and patience, and in wholeness of life. Grant that we with her may serve you now and always, rejoice in your glory. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. I'd like you to join in with the bold type, with the words in bold type. Give rest, O Christ, to your servants of your saints, where sorrow and pain are no more, neither sighing but life everlasting. You only are immortal, the creator and maker of humankind, and we are mortal, formed of the earth, and to the earth we shall return. For so did you ordain when you created me, saying, you are dust, and to dust you shall return. All of us go down to the dust, yet even at the grave we make our song, Alleluia, Alleluia, Alleluia. Give rest, O Christ, to your servant of your saints, where sorrow and pain are no more, neither sighing but life everlasting. Into your hands, O merciful Savior, we commend your servant Gloria. Acknowledge, we humbly beseech you, a sheep of your own fold, a lamb of your own flock, a sinner of your own redeeming. Receive her into the arms of your mercy, into the blessed rest of everlasting peace, and into the glorious company of the saints in light.
Amen. Amen.
Let us go forth in the name of Christ.
Oh, Lord, my God, guide my hand.
Go into the world in peace. Be of good courage. Hold fast to that which is good. Render unto no one evil for evil. Love the Lord your God. Love your neighbor. And love yourself. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be with you this day and forevermore. Let's go out into the world and rejoice in the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Please join us in the Guild Hall for refreshments and fellowship.